Oh, well, hello and welcome to tonight's organ recital on this rather special organ in Germany, in Regensburg. This is in the Holy Trinity Church in Regensburg. Now, the German word for Holy Trinity, Trinity Church, is rather long and a bit hard for me to say because I don't speak German very well. So I'm not going to embarrass myself by trying to say it. However, maybe someone will actually write it in the chat. That would be actually really useful. This organ has been released for a few months. It's by Pipeloops. And I've only just got it. And it's now entered into one of my favourite organs for Hauptwerk, simply because for a long time I've been looking for a good and adaptable, you know, a versatile Bach organ. This very much ticks all of the boxes that you could possibly want to tick for a Bach organ. So what does a Bach organ mean? It basically, so this organ, I should say, was built in inaugurated in 2020. So really, really recently. So 3 years old. But that is to say, if it had been built in the 18th century, when Bach had been, you know, the organ advisor, it's fair to say that a Bach organ like this would have very much met Bach's approval. Stable wind, reeds, couplers through the manuals, and things like that. And this organ is—it's so alive, isn't it? You know, here in England, we often get used to playing these sort of slushy Willis and Harrison organs. They're very romantic in their voicing, and very smooth. But this organ is bright, exciting, and playing that St. Anne on an organ like this is just revolutionary. So if you want to find out more, go out onto the Pipeloops website and check it out. You can buy it from there, or if you fancy buying it from BIS, you can buy it from the BIS shop as well. Well, you probably wouldn't buy it as well. You would probably buy it either or. You might want to buy it twice. I don't know. So moving on from Bach to Buxtehude, the first of two Passacaglias tonight. We're going to hear the Passacaglia in D minor by Dietrich Buxtehude, and then we'll hear Bach's monumental C minor at the end of the program. I play this rather quietly and build up in the middle and die down. I don't know whether that's authentic or not, but it's the way I quite like it. And it actually shows off now, we can explore some of these quieter fluty stops and other timbres. So, I'd love to know what you think about this organ. So chat away, let us know what your thoughts are, and I really hope you enjoy the Passacaglia in D minor by Dietrich Buxtehude.
Thank you.
I love that piece. I think it's so sweet. And for me, the way it's written at the end, it feels like it has to die away. I can't imagine that, those octaves played on a, you know, on a big planum. It just wants to just die away to nothing, I think. Let me know in the chat, how do you play that? How were you expecting to hear that? Was it what you expected? I know some people who've watched me before will have seen me play it in a similar way, but if you haven't seen me play it before, was that a surprise? So, this organ now, I'm gonna play something on this instrument which would have been really, really quite literally ahead of its time. If this organ had been built when Bach was around, Mendelssohn certainly hadn't been on the scene yet. He wasn't even thought of. I don't even know whether his parents were around. Probably not. No, they wouldn't have been. His grandparents might have just been around. But the organ sonatas work extremely well on organs like this. Number six, I thought would be very appropriate because it's based on a chorale, which Bach would have known. Vater unser in Himmelreich, and the Lord's Prayer, Our Father, which art in heaven. So I'm going to play this in a sort of in a way that I would have played it on a more, let's just say, a romantic organ. So now I'm going to see what the organ can do in terms of its romantic sounds. For example, at the very beginning, I've got all of the, let's just say, the foundation stops, the 8 and the 4, across all manuals, coupled together. And in the pedal, I've got all of the foundation, including the quint. So this organ doesn't have a 32-foot flue, but it has a quint. So that's at playing at the 5th. So that bottom D there, you're hearing a D and an A, which fakes the effect of a 32-foot flue. So I'll have all of that pulled out, and then you'll hear various solo reeds, and then of course a full organ at the relevant moments. Okay, so Mendelssohn's organ sonata number 6, which by the way, these were dedicated to Thomas Attwood, who was the organist of St. Paul's Cathedral in London. And Mendelssohn was a friend of Thomas Attwood, and although Mendelssohn wasn't an organist, he's obviously a very good pianist. He did write for the organ, and he did play the organ in an amateur way. And it's rather funny, I think it's rather funny actually, because if you consider how virtuosic some of Mendelssohn's music is, you know, his violin music, his orchestral music, and his piano music. When in the organ music, when the pedal part gets anything beyond moderately difficult, the hands suddenly go very easy, which means that he wanted to be able to play it himself. So if you'll, there's quite a well-known bit in this piece because it was on the grade 7 or grade 8 organ syllabus, ABRSM syllabus, for a pedal solo. At that moment, the pedal is quite tricky, but the hands just suddenly go really easy. But the rest of it is quite hard for the hands, but relatively easy for the pedal. There are lots of examples of that throughout all of his organ sonatas. So here we go. Number 6 in D minor. I'm doing all of the angles tonight, as well as playing and turning and doing all the registrations. Mm. What could go wrong? Where should we go first? Let's go here. ending there on the echo division on the strings. So actually the 4 foot and 2 foot strings, I don't know whether they're actually really strings, but played down the octave. So actually played down the octave makes it 4 foot and a 2 foot, an 8 foot and a 4 foot. And the good thing about playing, not only is are those stops really beautiful, the echo division is also enclosed. Which is unusual for a Baroque instrument, isn't it? But nevertheless, this organ has an enclosed echo division. And the flutes on here are really gorgeous, which you'll hear later on, well, and in the Sweelinck. So, speaking of Sweelinck, let's have a piece by him. His most famous piece, no less, this is Mein junges Leben hat ein End. This is for manuals only. And this would have been written long before J.S. Bach was even born. Bearing in mind, Sweelinck died in 1621. Bach was born in 1685. So Bach is possibly would have known his music. I don't know whether there's any evidence that he did know Sweelinck's music, but it's highly likely because Sweelinck was, in his day, a bit of a well-known figure, a virtuoso player, a very prolific composer. And of course, Bach himself, a great musician, would have done his research and studies, so he would have likely have studied Sweelinck's own music. So I'm going to start with the sort of the quinty sort of stuff on this and this in this piece. So you'll hear lots of quints, you'll hear lots of sort of Dutch colours, and you'll hear the planum on the final penultimate variation. And yes, well, I hope you enjoy. Nothing more to say. Mein junges Leben hat ein End by Sweelinck.
Thank you.
What a beautiful piece that is. Actually, I don't know whether it's harder than it sounds or not, but it is harder than you might think. Even though it's for manuals only, it's actually doesn't fit under the fingers entirely naturally. Sweelinck had a very different way of fingering runs, which I'll be honest with you, I'm not entirely used to. So I had to work quite hard fingering that, working it out, and working out where on earth these hands should be going. There's a wonderful performance, by the way, just calling back to a previous recital which Martin Baker gave on this channel. He played that and actually this next piece. And he played them both extremely well. And I would highly recommend checking out the Martin Baker organ recital from BIS. Plays those pieces on the Rotterdam sample set. So that brings us into our final piece this evening. The J.S. Bach Passacaglia in C minor, or as it's now known, the Passacaglia and Fugue in C minor. This piece, for me, is perfect, I think, for the season of Lent or Advent, when there is a feeling of waiting and a feeling of watching and anticipation. So I play this piece in that sort of way. It starts off in C minor, starts off very sort of slow because it's quite sparse in its writing, particularly on the first page. And gradually, as it progresses, it becomes more and more enveloped and exciting and tense before ending on a huge chord of C major. So it's like the beginning is you're waiting in the darkness, and then at the end, you've finally arrived. This is quite an early piece by Bach, actually. This was written in his earlier years, so this might predate, you know, such pieces as the Prelude and Fugue in B minor, and other later pieces like that. So this is him really pushing the boundaries of himself and what's possible. And he would have very much liked to have played this piece on an organ like this. And this organ does this piece extremely well. And I know, JSB, if you're listening, if you're watching, it's a scary thought, this organ, you'll approve of this organ. So our final piece tonight, the Passacaglia in C minor by J.S. Bach. Would Bach have used the Schimmelstern at the end? I don't see why not. It suddenly goes to C major at the end for the first time in the entire piece. And it's there to be used, isn't it? Actually, there were two Schimmelsterns, actually. Let me give you a demo of them both. So push that one in. So, the first one, I'm not quite sure why there are two, but there are. So the first one is like this. Oh, I can't do both. That's annoying. Oh, I can. That's the first one. And the second one.
Quite noisy, aren't they?
They are a bit. And they're both together. How about that? This organ also has a carillon, which didn't use.
Quite in tune.
No, it's probably more appropriate for this sort of thing. Name the piece and name the composer. Right, so there we are, this wonderful Bach organ, built in 2020, so only built fairly recently. And this is what it looks like.
Oh, so it's not Baroque organ at all?
No, well, it's... So
it's
I was
trying to be a Baroque organ.
I was explaining to the chat earlier that it's built in the style of a Baroque organ. It's a Bach organ, which means that he would have approved of it. So if you go onto his website, the Pipeloops website, it says that what makes a Bach organ? So a sufficient and stable wind, which we have here, both for the large pedal stops and for the arbitrary addition of the fundamental voices, i.e. the foundation stops. Gravitas, although also through large reed stops in the sense of fullness and depth. So that's like the big planums and the reeds on the pedal, you know, the full sound, the principles along with the 16 foot on the manuals. An expressive sound concept with a view to the various construction forms of something or other. and as I said earlier, coupling for all the manuals. An appreciation for the bassoon sound, which we didn't actually have tonight. There's the bassoon, chimes, and mixtures across all divisions, containing the third. So the mixture on the Hauptwerk, mixture on the Überwerk, and then the mixture on the Echo. All together. It's like Christmas. There we go. So I really hope that you enjoyed this concert tonight of music. You heard two pieces by Bach, starting with the St. Anne, the Prelude and Fugue in E flat major at the very beginning, going into the Passacaglia in D minor by Buxtehude, and then into the organ sonata number 6 by Mendelssohn, Sweelinck's minors, junges, Leben, hat ein end, and then the Passacaglia, which you just heard by Bach at the end. So I hope that has convinced you that if you're in the market for such an organ for your Hauptwerk setup, a Bach organ, which does Bach extremely well, this might be the one. And Mendelssohn, and Sweelinck, and Buxtehude, yes. and I will be using it for when I play the trio sonatas again. I will definitely be using this organ, and I'll be using it again for practice of the chorale preludes and the orgel buchline, etc., etc. Go check it out on either my website or on the Pipeloops website directly. Thank you to those who have donated. I haven't been able to see because I've obviously been playing the organ and doing all of that.
Jerry and Ian just recently donated.
Thank you very much, Jerry and Ian. That's very kind of you.
And the ticker ticks on to 100,000.
We are inching closer,
we are,
aren't we?
Ticking on.
So if you know of anyone,
the question is, can we tick over during VC tomorrow? If you know anyone who has a YouTube account, just tell them to subscribe tomorrow.
No, that's not always a good thing.
Why not?
Because people who just subscribe for the sake of it won't watch the videos.
Don't tell them to do that.
That's bad for the analytics. Don't do that.
No.
If you like organ music, please subscribe. Please tell your friends. We'll get there very soon. Or if you're watching and you haven't even subscribed, just click the subscribe button. We are very, very close. Oh, somebody called Coffee has just donated. Thank you very much.
Yes, he does play Pachelbel's canon.
I can play the Pachelbel canon, I think you mean. I can. Yes, I can, and I will play that for you at some point. Not tonight. Good. See you tonight, tomorrow night at Virtual Church. We'll see. We might use this organ. We might use a different one. You'll have to wait and see. All right, guys. Take care. See you tomorrow. Stay safe and cheerio. Goodbye.